Today's class is just a continuation of that exercise we considered last time, where we looked at the theorem. We are now going to move into a final section on edge testing packages. This is in fact last time. So we'll continue from that point. Then we'll move over to the next section of these squares, which is going to be our focus then for the next week. So let's just do a quick recap then of where we were last time, and then go back to the POV example. So we call that a stable. When we look at pair tests, that there's something in common between our experiment elements that we're doing the experiment model. And for example, if we look at the drug trial, there's one person who may receive the placebo, and that person may not receive the active drug. When they receive the active drug first, and they receive the placebo. And then I think Ben was asking you a question afterwards. But just the very act of taking the tablet tends to change that person's effect. Okay, that happens. So someone might take this tablet, and just the act of taking this tablet might make them feel that it's working. Whereas the placebo only act, they don't know. And so that act of taking the tablet might lower their blood pressure by, say, for example, 3 units. Just the act of taking the tablet itself. Now, if the drug was actually a real drug that had some success, let's say the actual drug lowered their blood pressure by 10 units. Okay. So the actual drug really had an effect of 7 units plus the additional 3 just from the person taking the drug itself. So a 10-unit decrease is observed. 7 of those units are due to the drug. 3 units are just to the person's psychological effect. And you observe that same 3-unit decrease just because of the placebo. When you do the subtraction of the placebo's effect, which is a 3-unit decrease, and you subtract off the 10-unit decrease from when they took the drug, you recover that 7 value itself. So the pair testing works really well to cancel out background effects for us. And we'll use pair testing when we want a more sensitive statistical test, because it cancels out these background effects, with the important assumption that that background effect is always present. Okay, so that's the key criteria, that background effect, that commonality, is present in both the A experiment and the B experiment, so that it can cancel out. Okay, now we will see occasions next in the next section, the DOE section, where we get interactions. So we'll talk about what interactions are. They serve to complicate the story a little bit more. But in general, if we consider the effects to be additive, then we can subtract them out and then work with the difference. So we looked at that example of the drug trial, we looked at the example of the additive being added to a lubricant, we considered the example of coating on a piece of paper. So there again, the same idea is if the paper has an effect on the moisture repellent properties, it's going to cancel out in both cases. Present in the A experiment, one coating, and it's present in the B experiment, another coating. Another example of where this is extremely common is if you've got batches of material. So here we've got 5 batches of material, only enough material to do 2 experiments from each batch of material. So we ended up the last class by considering how to best allocate our 10 experiments to those 5 lots of material. And the way we decided at the end is not to ever do it sequentially, because any effect that persists in those first 5 variables, in those first 5 experiments, might change and not be present in the next 5 experiments, and then you can mistakenly attribute a change when there's not really one present. So never do experiments sequentially in the order that you decide them. The suboptimal approach is to do randomization. We'll talk about randomization a lot more coming up. But then the far better approach is to use a pair test so that effect cancels out. So we've got this idea that we need to do a pair test today. Let's take a look at how we do it. So I'll put this recipe up there. And what I'm going to do is just showing you how you apply that in the context of the nanometric example and the dilution example. So on another slide in front of you, you'll have the raw data there. I'll just write out the first few entries. Before we had the nanometric case, we had dilution data. And let's consider where we're calculating the difference between them this time. So the nanometric result the first time was 25 units, and the next time was 11 units. What we'll do is we'll call our difference W, and I'll define that in this case as nanometric minus dilution. We end up creating a third column that's the difference between those, so we put in the value of 14. Notice that it isn't about the element here. Compare the test is valid in this case because we're taking one sample of water and splitting it and measuring the nanometric method, DOD, measuring the dilution method, DOD. The common element in this particular experiment is the sample of water itself that I'm taking. So this might be, for example, the sample of water that I take from Lake Ontario. And I get those two DOD values. Then I go take a sample of water from the Burlington wastewater treatment plant, for example, and I might get the DODs that I record next, say 3 and 26. Notice now when I calculate the difference here of minus 23, it's the same body of water. We want our system recall back to what the ideal was here. We're measuring the VOD using two different methods. We don't want our measurement technique to depend on the water sample, its origin. So if we're going to take one sample of water from one location, there's my VOD values, and I calculate the difference. Then I take another sample from another body of water, and I can go repeat this, and in fact the data that you have there are for 11 sources of water. 27 to 18, and then the difference is plus 9. The fourth measurement was 30, 16, and the difference recorded was 14. So what we end up with, we repeat this several times, is 11 data points, you calculate 11 differences, so you'll get 11 W values. So 11 differences, nanometric minus dilution. And what you can show then with this data set is that the average difference will be R is 6.27. And the standard deviation of those 11 W's is 11.77. So I'll call this S W bar. The standard deviation of the W bar value is equal to 11.77. And there were 11 of these cases. And our goal with this section is to calculate whether this difference of 6.27 is that statistically significant difference. Like that difference, if these two methods really are equivalent, should be zero. We didn't get a zero value, we got a value of 6.27. We got a standard deviation of 11 units. Is this method showing that, is this analytical technique of the nanometric method versus the dilution method, are they really equivalent to what we're asking? So what we're going to do is we're going to construct a confidence interval for that difference. So let's call that difference UW. UW is the true difference between the two methods. And we're going to find a lower bound and an upper bound for this difference. And what should LB and UB, what should those numeric values be if there is no difference? Negative and positive. And ideally they should span zero, roughly symmetric. If we don't expect them to be identically symmetrical, but we do expect those lower bounds and upper bounds to span zero. So we can go ahead then and use these 11 W values and make our regular assumption to construct the confidences. We assume that those differences are independent. So these 11 values, these differences, they are independent of each other. That's quite easy to guarantee if you've taken your samples independently. So in this case, that would require me to sample from independent bodies of water. Calculate the mean difference and the standard deviation. I've done those over here for you. And then we're saying we're assuming that W bar comes from a normal distribution with that mean and that standard of their variance. Then we can go ahead and construct confidence. So go ahead and calculate what your lower bound and upper bound should be. You've got your table of the T distribution in front of you. Calculate the 95% confidence interval for mu W. Almost second hand by now. So you've got all the data that you need. Is plus minus Ct times Sw over root A. So if you sum in those values over there, that's 6.27. But bounds there would be 6, so that's plus or minus 2.23. The standard deviation is 11.77. And root N is root 11 in this case. So what you'll get then is, in fact, the lower bound is minus 1.64. And your upper bound is 14.18. So let's just take a second to get that down so we can interpret it. So the interpretation of that confidence interval then would be what in this particular case? No statistical difference between the two methods again. Okay, so again, here, as before, that asymmetry in the bound makes us recognize that there might be a practical difference. Statistically, there is no difference, but from a practical point of view, that asymmetry gives us some hesitation to say that there is no difference.
So, we don't need labels. Yes,
okay, so in a test, however the question is phrased, but it will often go along the lines of, what is your recommendation to your manager? Right, because it's one thing to have statistics, but what are you going to tell your boss? What are you going to recommend? Should you go with the dilution method because it's a cheaper method? In the next assignment, there's a question that shows you have to give an answer. Choose one of the particular methods, A or B. But at the end of the day, you can't just sit back and say, this is what I get. You have to move forward from the point. So in this particular case, our statistical results show that there is no difference. But from a practical point of view, why are we getting such a large difference in the two methods? Might be the first thing I want to know. Even though statistically there's no difference, we saw when we looked at the raw data, that Jenna pointed out that it's so biased towards the one side. Those three points, the dimension points, are all higher up than the dilution points. So which method is more accurate? Well, in a company, it might be well known in your area of work that the bathymetric method is the gold standard or the general standard. You're trying to replace the bathymetric method with the dilution method because it's a cheaper alternative. So what you've got here right now is evidence that the dilution method is giving you values that are almost always lower than the reference method, the bathymetric method. So even though from a statistical point of view, those numbers seem to indicate that it's only the same, from a practical point of view, we're seeing a difference. And in fact, what's really interesting is when you're dealing with paired data, you just plot the pairs themselves. So here you go is a plot of the pairs and the differences. So there's my 11 data points. You've got this graph flipped. I intentionally flipped it for you. I'll talk about why I've done that. But notice here all the pairs except one are positive. If these two systems were equivalent to each other, those pairs should be both positive and negative, randomly. If the two methods really were identical, you should see pairs that are roughly scattered around here. The fact that you've got this sum under 2, which is a very large negative 23 over here, is telling you you've got that one data point pulling you down. That's what's causing your confidence interval over there to be just over the negative edge. If I delete this point number 2 and redo this confidence interval for paired differences, absolutely, that confidence interval is going to have two positive numbers, the lower bound and the upper bound. So, asymmetric confidence interval almost always points us to go back to the raw data and do some further work and some further investigation.
So, that
I would do some more work, and in fact, that is the work you're going to have to do in assignment 3. So, the reason why I flipped the graph is just to emphasize that it really doesn't matter which way around you do the pairing. Here, I calculated W to be manometric minus dilution, but if you calculated dilution minus manometric, these signs just flip. Sorry, these numbers are different, I should say. The mean is a negative of this, so it's minus 6.27. The standard deviation remains identical. The standard deviations, by definition, are insensitive to sign changes. So what would happen then is your W would change sign, that would become minus W, and everything else just flips around. So this would be minus 6.27 plus or minus that bound, and then in fact your lower bound would be minus 14.2, and your upper bound would be plus 1.64. So it really doesn't matter which way around you do your difference, just you get a mirror image, the interpretations of it. Either take your samples or investigate your raw data to see what's related to that difference. Yeah, it's very clear that point number 2 is biased to you to get the incorrect conclusion. Yes, Priya.
Only got enough material for a certain quantity of experiments.
Now, in the ideal world, if you're doing these 10 experiments, one option you can consider is to simply say, let me take material 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, blend them together in a large container, and then split them out into 10 portions to do my 10 experiments. 5 of A, 5 of B, random this time. But it's not always practical. What if these material sizes refer to like tons? Right? So each of these batches is 2-3 tons. We don't have a container large enough to do this blending for us. So in many cases, it's impractical or impossible to blend out that. So we have to deal with material. However, the key here is our aim is not to test the effect of the material. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Material 1 might have an effect. It's different to material 2. It's different to material 3 because there might be impurities or other sources of contamination in the material. Our purpose with this test is to test whether process A is any different to process B. And furthermore, when we find out our result, we really want process A versus process B. If we get a difference, we want it to be consistent difference that is independent of the source of material. So error tests are always appropriate when we've got a common element that we're not testing for. My goal here is it's a common element of material, but I'm not testing for differences of material. My purpose is to test for process errors. So there's a subtle and important difference. Okay, so I've got a lot of coverage there on this topic.